And now we'll listen to a second song. And this song was composed at the end of the 19th century, although I think that scholars don't agree on a date for it. It was composed by Alma Mahler, who was for a time married to Gustav Mahler. And after his death, she married a couple of other famous artists, Walter Gropius, and then finally Franz Werfel. Let's look at the poem and its translation. The poem is by Rainer Maria Rilke, "Bei dir ist es traut." And the translation is something like this: "I feel warm and close with you. Clocks strike hesitantly like they did in distant days. Say something loving to me, but not aloud. A gate opens somewhere out in the burgeoning. Evening listens at the window panes. Let us stay quiet. No one knows us thus." So it's a portrait of the intimacy between lovers. We're not sure whether the narrator is a man or a woman. The imagery is a little peculiar, but it gives an emotional picture of a relationship. I selected this song partly because it comes at the opposite end of the century from the Schubert song, and partly because of its interesting harmonies. Also, it's kind of short. I'll do what I did before, and I will play the entire song for you, and then we will go through it bit by bit. The harmonic analysis of this song is much more difficult, and maybe to some extent the harmonic analysis is not the point. I'm not sure that we learn a lot about the structure of the song by labeling each one of the chords, but it is interesting to see what sorts of methods that we've encountered earlier this semester show up in this song. We're in the key of D major, and as in the song of Lecture 2, we start out by prolonging tonic for a few measures as a way of setting up the key. Then the bass descends down from D to C sharp to C and to B. And when we get to the B, it's clearly a 4-6 chord, but I think the previous measures don't really make a lot of sense in terms of a Roman numeral analysis. It's an expression of linear chromaticism, but not really of functional harmony. We stick around the 4 chord for a few measures, and then we move towards the flat 3, towards F major, and we then have the same sort of 1-4 progression in F major that we had before, and then we return to a 5-7 chord ending this part of the song. And again, it's kind of a common tone modulation. There's an A in the upper voice of the piano part, both for the F major chord and also for the A major chord. I consider this first page of the song to be the first half of a binary. It's basically an A-B form. This first page has a particular type of music. It sticks very close to the A440 in the vocal line. There's also this emphasis on not just on the A440 in the piano and in the vocal part, but also in the BA. The piano has a repetitive rhythmic figure. All of the music hangs together, I think, largely because of that repeated rhythmic figure. When we reach the 5 chord at the end of the page, that's probably the clearest harmonic signpost that we've had on the entire page. Let's listen again to this first page of music. In the second part of the song, we have completely different music. We still have the grace note B going to A, although it's now mostly in a different octave. And we have a different rhythm in the piano part. We have these marching quarter notes and a different rhythm as well in the vocal part, although the vocal part still stays very close to the A440. And we have a lot of descending stepwise motion, including a vocal cadence that goes from the B down to the A. On this second page of music in the B section, we have a lot of D sharp diminished seventh chords, D sharp, F sharp, A, C. Much of the time, those are common tone diminished seventh chords leading to a 5 chord. The A is the common tone between them. But sometimes that chord is acting as a 7 diminished 7 of 2, leading to a 2 chord in root position, and later on leading to a 2 chord in first inversion. Some of the harmony gets a little peculiar through the second line, but basically what we have is an alternation between diminished seventh chords and mostly triads, some dominant seventh chords. Again, when we get to the end of this stanza of the poem, we have a more traditional chord progression. We tonicize 2, go to 2-6, then go to the secondary leading tone chord of 5, which leads us to a cadential 6-4, which then goes to 5-7, and then goes to 1. And then there's a short reminiscence of the opening music before the song closes itself off. Let's listen to that. So that's Bei dir ist es traut by Alma Mahler. And my final lecture from chapter 30 will talk a little bit about the augmented 5 triad and how the augmented five triad can also be enharmonically reinterpreted, like the diminished seventh chords and like the German augmented sixth major minor seventh pair, to help us effect a modulation by a major third up or a major third down. So that's coming up in the next lecture. Thank you.